First off, for this little comparison, let's take a look at the Flash CS4, and this is the first version that had any sort of bones or inverse kinematics. And I'm going to show y'all, kind of how it works, and to be honest, one of the problems with it. And I've already got things set up, so you can see the bone structure right here. The body is connected to the arm and then the hand, and this is my initial pose on frame one here. And then if I were to move this, you can see it's going to create a keyframe for me there. And then just scrubbing between the two just interpolates the two poses. Let's go ahead and put in one more keyframe out this way. And here's the problem. Let's say at this pose right here, I want to scale the hand up a little bit. Okay, maybe it's visually going to be coming forward somewhat in space. So I go over here to the free transform tool, and let's make this a bit bigger. I'll kind of exaggerate this. I mean, you just scaled up, you know, way too much. Because you can see now that scale has occurred on all three these keyframes here. So that's a big problem in my opinion, because why would it be doing it on all three there? Same thing's gonna occur for a skew. So let's say I just skewed it up slightly like that. Okay, the hand is gonna stay skewed on all of those. Okay, so it's kind of the anti-animation tool there, because it's there's no change over time. One other problem is that you're probably going to want to swap out symbols because right now we have a pretty stiff arm pose, which could occur, let's say, in a walk cycle at one frame, but then a little bit later you might want to bend it a little bit as the arm comes forward or backward. And you can't do that. You can't swap out symbols midway. And just to give you an example, I'll go over here to symbol, swap symbol, and we'll just take the hand because that's the only other one I have another symbol for. Click on OK. All right, well, it worked for that one frame, but again, it stays throughout there. So again, this is a big problem for someone that's a character animator. It's just not going to fly, at least with this setup. And of course, you could animate in Flash without creating a hierarchy like this. But I think that's why else put in some sort of inverse kinematics if you're not going to have it set up for character animation. And I've read on many forums and things like that, well, you could use ActionScript to do it, some of the things that I've just showed you that don't work. But let's face it, I mean, if you're doing animation, you need to be able to see it in real time on the timeline instead of having to go and create another layer up here and put in actions or action script or code to animate with. So kind of a disappointment. Maybe Flash will correct things one day, but let's go and take a look at a program that's got it working right now. That is Toon Boom Animate, and you can see that I've got pretty much the same thing here, hands, arm, and body. And let's go ahead and rig them up. So what I'll do is take the arm and drag this kind of on top of the body there. I don't want to say underneath, because visually you might be thinking that the arm is then going to appear underneath the body layer, because that's how the layer arrangement is. But that's actually something that you can control separately with the Z depth, which is again great that you can even control that. That's actually incredible. If you're coming from a Flash background, you kind of always think, well, okay, if your body is above, body layer is above the arm, the hands, then on stage here, it's going to be that your body is going to be visually on top of that, which would, of course, look kind of crazy because, the body would be in front of it. So all I did there was just by dragging those layers around. Now I've rigged them up, and a good indication that that's going on is that there's this little triangle here, so I can kind of fold up the entire body like so, or just fold up the arm. And you might be wondering, well, hey, how come things turn pink when you select them like that? And that's because it's showing me that this is the parent that I have selected, and then what's in yellow are the children and the hierarchy of that parent. So it's a good visual indication of what's going on, especially if you have like a really complex thing that you're animating. If I were to just to select on the arm here, you can see then that turns pink, and then just the hand is yellow. So there's some nice visual cues in there. And what we'll do is let's go ahead and give ourselves a few more frames to work with. Let me extend out actually this as well. And I'm just going to hit F5 to extend our exposure here. And let's take a look at drawing substitutions number one, because I think actually that is one of the most important things that they have in here. What we'll do though is animate this just slightly. What I'll do is rotate the hands. Actually, let's rotate the arm first. So move that. You can see that just by rotating it, it's got my keyframe in there, and it's already plugging away at doing a motion tween. And let's rotate the hand as well. And by the way, you can scale these, of course, as you should be able to, and have that show up as well. All right, now let's say that halfway through here, I want the hand to no longer be in that pose, but to be kind of making like a grappling pose. And I can do that because I've already got some extra artwork inside of this symbol. Okay, so if I were to double click inside of it, you can see that there's three frames of artwork in here. Okay, let's come back over here to the main timeline. And you don't swap out symbols like you would in Flash to change out artwork. What you do is you go over here to your drawing substitution panel, and you got this nice little scroll bar to just scrub through all the artwork that is inside of that particular symbol. So I've just moved this to frame 3, and it's showing me the artwork that's on frame 3. And you're not actually making a keyframe on the timeline, because if you were making a keyframe, then it would be also keying your, like your scaling, your position, and all that stuff. So they've totally separated out that type of change or pose change. And again, you know, when you're animating, the more kind of separation of all the things, the better. So we've still got our motion tween occurring here, which is tweening a little bit of scaling. Maybe I can make this even bigger to kind of prove that fact. So it's scaling our rotation, our position, all that stuff. And then you get this little line right in the middle of the timeline there that's just indicating that that's where we made that pose change. So come back over here, then maybe move this again. You can see I get another little line there just showing me that I've made some visual change, made that drawing substitution. And yeah, that's kind of just the beauty of how that works. So let's see, let's take this, let's move the body at the same time. Oops, actually, I'm sorry, I need to move it on a frame other than frame 1. All right, so I can move that over there. And of course, everything is moving along nicely with that. One other cool thing though, I just undid that, is that maybe in this case you wouldn't even want to have your body be the main catalyst for moving all these other parts. What you could do is select the body, then come over here and create a peg layer. Okay, so click on that. And what that'll be used for is kind of in a way almost grouping all of your stuff together and then having that group be animated as well. And if you are coming from a Flash background, you could think of that almost like taking all your layers of animation and then putting them inside of a movie clip and then keyframing the movie clip on the main timeline. But again, this is great because you can just keep everything right here. Visually, you can see it. You can get to it very quickly. But now I've got this peg layer, so I could start I could move it over here. Move this guy over here. Do whatever I need to do to it. Scale it up. And then I've got everything accessible down below that. So let's also take a look at the Z depth, because that's fun to play with. So let's say this, let's actually suppose that this arm is going back some. So let me rotate it like so. And I do actually have some symbols I can swap out for this. There we go, that looks a bit better. And the only thing we'd have to do there is just adjust this arm at the point that it, or the hand that, where it changes. Okay, so let's extend this out just a little bit further. Oops, there we go. So let's suppose right here, and then the frame after that, we want this arm to visually be behind the body. So what we could do is expand out here, and we get some of our kind of extra properties